Good evening, everyone. My name is Carrie, and I am part of the programming team here at the library, and I'd like to welcome you all to this evening's event. I'd like to just do a brief intro for our presenter tonight, Arlen Schumer, before I bring him up. Arlen is an award-winning comic book style illustrator and comics pop culture historian. His book, The Silver Age of Comic Book Art, won the Independent Book Publishers Award for Best Popular Culture Book, and ABC's 2020 named him one of the country's preeminent authorities on comics and culture. His other books are Visions from the Twilight Zone and the Neil Adams Sketchbook. He lectures on these and other pop culture subjects at universities and cultural institutions nationwide. Please help me in welcoming Arlen Schumer to the stage tonight.
Thank you, Carrie, for that great introduction. I want to thank the Westport Library for hosting me. I want to thank you all for coming out here on a hot August night. And I just want to say that I am really honored and humbled to be at such a beautiful institution in Westport, delivering tonight's presentation on one of Westport's truly greatest American sons. So on that note, ladies and gentlemen, let us begin.
Single bound.
Look, up in the sky. It's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman. Yes, it's Superman, strange visitor from another planet who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Superman, who can change the course of mighty rivers, bend steel in his bare hands, and who, disguised as Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for a great metropolitan newspaper, fights a never-ending battle for truth, justice, and the American way. Another exciting episode in the adventures of Superman.
And on behalf of the Westport Library, let me welcome you all to Curt Swan, the baby boomer's Superman artist. I wish I had a lightning sound effect to go with that, my lightning image. And my name, folks, is Arlen Schumer. I did a book about comic book history in the 1960s called The Silver Age of Comic Book Art, which reflects what was happening the decade in the art of Curt Swan and a bunch of other of the great artists of his generation. There's a double page spread of so many of Curt Swan's iconic images, many of which you'll be seeing tonight in detail. That was his signature that I got when I met Curt Swan in 1992. Now, this image is not from 92, but that's an image of probably in the mid to late 50s when Curt Swan started drawing Superman full time for the next 29 years. Now, this image is probably closer in age to when he drew this self-portrait, I think in the early 80s. And you can see that for many of us, there's really only one Superman artist. Now, this is one of the last covers that he did, signaling the end of his full-time run in 1986, which started 29 years earlier, almost to the exact month, in 1957. Now, Curt Swan, overnight, kind of figuratively and literally replaced the Superman artist of the previous decade named Wayne Boring. And you can see by this image from circa 1948, very barrel-chested, the anatomy is not really accurate anatomy. And you can see in many ways, Curt Swan, for many of us, was the first realistic comic artist. And I use the term realistic in quotes because that could have many derivations. But Curt Swan was the right artist at the right time to give readers of an entire generation the iconic models of what became the Superman family. And under the aegis of editor Mort Weisinger, who we're going to talk about later, Curt Swan was able to redraw all of what I call the superstations of the cross of Superman's life that you all know, whether you're a in-depth Superman fan or you know of him from the TV show or the movies, you know these superstations of the cross. So Swan not only did the life of Superman, but also the most memorable death of Superman story, which in DC's terms was called an imaginary story. All comic book stories are imaginary, but this was an imaginary story, and from 1960, written by Jerry Siegel, Superman's creator, by the way, but you could see in images that really evoke a lot of the naturalism and the emotion that Swan was called for. And I remember reading this story when I was 10 years old in a reprint in one of those annual editions in my grandmother's apartment in the Bronx. And I remember the way we remember things when we were younger, you never realize the things you're gonna remember. But when I got to that last panel, all I feel is a great sorrow, the passing, the strongest, kindest, most powerful human being I've ever known, sob, my cousin Superman, with a great swan drawing of Superman like a ghostly image in the clouds. I remember crying at 10 years old and the teardrops hitting that panel. That's how memorable Curt Swan's Superman was. Another great story that he did, also written by Jerry Siegel, Superman's Return to Krypton, circa 1961 maybe. He introduced Supergirl to the world in 1962. For the previous 4 years, she was kept hidden as like his secret weapon. And then the more you know about the Superman lore, when Superman and Jimmy Olsen shrunk down to go to the bottle city of Kandor, they adopted the identities of Nightwing and Flamebird. So this is a shout out to all you fans that might remember Nightwing and Flamebird. This was the very first comic book cover I remember seeing as a kid. I was 5 years old in summer camp in 1963. And I remember seeing this incredible image. Curt Swan penciled that, and the head of DC Comics coloring named Jack Adler painted the gray tones to make it look like a real silver statue. The year later, 1964, there was this annual cover. And this idea of Superman and the world, the same year this annual came out, Curt Swan illustrated a story which posited the idea that what if Superman used his superpowers to make himself king of Earth, to subjugate the rest of us? This was like a nightmare vision of Superman that Curt Swan pulled off in his inimitable manner. Look at the dialogue. My first command is that your nations replace their flags with my Superman banner. And there it is, done. But, you know, in addition to Superman being portrayed as all-powerful, some of the most memorable stories Swan illustrated was where Superman lost his powers. If you know your Superman lore, under the red sun, he loses his powers. Or what about this cover from 1965, where Superman confronts his own identity of Clark Kent? In fact, the story, Clark Kent's Incredible Delusion, actually has Clark Kent visiting a psychiatrist to discuss his situation with Superman. Now, a lot of people think Marvel Comics in the 60s was ahead of DC. Well, this story came out 5 months before the great Steve Ditko over at Marvel Comics did this classic issue of Spider-Man, where he thinks he's going crazy and visits a psychiatrist. So Mort Weisinger and Swan were ahead by 5 months of Marvel. Now, in 1967, when John Romita did this, one of the single greatest Spider-Man covers and one of the greatest comic book covers of all time, this came out a couple months before Swan did one of his greatest Superman covers, which was this one. So the New York comic book world was a tiny world. Everybody had lunch at the same places. For all we know, the people at DC got wind of that Spider-Man image, and maybe that's why this one happened. But Curt Swan not only did Superman, he drew every cover of every Superman family title during those 29 years as well. So many Superboy covers and stories that I could do a whole presentation just on his Superboy covers. And as you can see, the setting for Superboy was always about Smallville, the town in Kansas where Superman grew up with his adopted parents. And Curt Swan, going back to the late 50s, would be drawing these beautiful landscapes that was either about Smallville in the future or more likely Smallville in the present, with the all-American white picket fence and a boy and his dog and the classic ghostly image that Curt Swan was called upon to draw multiple times. But I don't think anybody has ever drawn crypto better than Curt Swan. I mean, it's tough to draw animals. I'm an artist. I can't draw animals to save my life. Now, there's a loving side of crypto, but then there were stories like this. I mean, look at this dialogue, you dumb mutt. Don't you know I'm invulnerable? You can't hurt me, and now I'm gonna give you the lesson of your life. And then, of course, crypto can think in English. Suddenly, I hate my master Superboy. I wish I could tear him apart. But more often, Curt Swan was called upon to draw these very Americana scenes in Superboy, as you can see in this montage. I mean, look at that beautiful, classic American house. Look, Clark Kent's brother in the story is Lex Luthor. Or how about Superman and Batman are brothers? Now, every time I look at this image from 1967, I always think of Norman Rockwell's Thanksgiving image, because it has that same Rockwellian Americana aspect to it. Now, believe it or not, Superman by Curt Swan has made it into the fine art painting world. This is a 1962 painting by the pop artist named Mel Ramos. Now, this is a later, he passed away a few years ago. He was based in San Francisco, so this is a picture of him in his later years. But as you can see by the background, he was the third of the trinity of early pop artists after Andy Warhol and Roy Lichtenstein. Ramos painted advertising images, candy packages, as you can see, pin-up images of women. But in 1961, Andy Warhol did one of the first pop art paintings based on, not a Curt Swan panel, but a panel by the Lois Lane artist, the great Kurt Schaffenberger, who drew a very unique take on Superman. But I think Mel Ramos took a look at what Warhol was doing, and in 1962, a year later, he decided to pick this cover, penciled by Swan, and if we come in on that figure, that's exactly the painting. And if you look closely, you can see he favored a very three-dimensional painting technique where you could really see the thickness of the brushstrokes. He did many other paintings, Batman, The Phantom, and his painting style was influenced by his teacher, the great Wayne Thiebaud, who also recently passed away. But he made a whole artistic career out of this very three-dimensional, thick painting style. So it's kind of ironic that Ramos would pick this very almost a flaccid image of Superman by Swan, when in the early 60s, Swan was doing more dynamic images like this. Or what he really became known for were his flying images of Superman. The pose that he gave Superman that he would repeat over and over again during the 1960s was the unique Superman pose of the fist raised and the leg half bent. Curt Swan even did this autobiographical image of himself as Superman. What's that? Bird, you're blind as a bat. That's Bird Leg Swan Man, Man of Feathers. Anyway, you can see here the classic Superman. Again, everybody's drawn Superman flying, but nobody's drawn him as perfectly flying as these Curt Swan images that I'm showing you. Every one is just iconic. Every drawing is just a perfect drawing. And again, he did so many of these in his career, and I really believe nobody's done it better than Curt Swan. Now look down below, it says here, the first story of the Legion of Superheroes. They were a title that Curt Swan not only drew the covers of, starting in early 1960 or 61, but in 1965, he started drawing the interiors for the next 3 years. But you can see in these special features, Curt Swan became known as the artist of the Legion of Superheroes, of which there were a lot of them, but Curt Swan just drew perfect images of every single one of them. The covers, I mean, just editing down which covers I should show you. He drew the Legion in times of love and in times of war. And some of the interior art of Curt Swan's Legion was among his best. And I think the apogee of Curt Swan's Legion career was in 1967, when we were met with this cover, where we'll be shocked by the identity of the Doom Legionnaire. One of the Legion of Superheroes was going to die. Now, in comic books, nobody ever died. Or if they died, they all came back to life. But here, DC Comics is telling us one of these Legionnaires is going to die. So in this story, if you notice, the superhero named Pharaoh Lad, Pharaoh is Latin for iron. He's DC's version of Iron Man. You can see he takes the bomb that has to explode the enemy gas. Don't even ask me to explain the plot. The bottom line is Superboy is going to sacrifice himself, but Pharaoh Lad punches Superboy out by turning himself into iron. Now, here's a little digression. This was the introduction of Pharaoh Lad. He was created by the DC writer Jim Shooter, who was a teenager at the time, and he gave DC Comics a knockoff of Iron Man that they could use. Now, I remember reading The Legion as an 8-year-old. I loved Pharaoh Lad because I loved Iron Man. Who didn't like Pharaoh Lad? But of course, who did they decide to kill? Pharaoh Lad sacrifices himself, blows himself up, and look at this final scene. Brainiac 5 says, not even my computer brain can find a way to gather the scattered particles that were Pharaoh Lad from millions of miles of space, invisible kid. I know, Brainiac, but we'll still have a memorial to him, that special missile which will stand through eternity on the cemetery satellite Shangalia, the resting place of heroes from all over the universe. Pharaoh's Lad sacrifice will be remembered forever. I'm 8 years old. This was the first time I wrote a letter to DC Comics complaining that they killed Pharaoh Lad. And I'm still upset over it. And how many years later is it? Somebody do the math. Yeah, I haven't forgotten. At least in the early 80s, when Curt Swan did this incredible pinup of all the Legionnaires, they included Pharaoh Lad. So I don't know, maybe they revived him somehow. Don't ask me why. But you can see that nobody, a lot of artists have drawn the Legion over the years, but nobody has drawn the Legion of Superheroes so perfectly as Curt Swan. Now, these look like they were part of what are called model sheets that an artist might prepare for other artists to take over the strip when they leave. And you can see Curt Swan's attention to detail. I mean, back then, they didn't make figure models. You know, now you go to a comic book store, there are statues, figures, statuettes. There was none of that when we were kids. DC didn't give us anything. But it looks like these would have made great models for some statuettes that they never made. But anyway, Curt Swan did a lot of model sheets over the years that were printed in the comic books that you can see. And let me tell you something, folks, for young artists who came of age at this time, it's not like nowadays where there are tutorials about how to draw comics. Every art school is teaching comics. When I was a kid, they all looked down on comics. There was, when DC Comics would do a page like this, it was like manna from heaven in comic book form. Here's another one that he did. These are all from, I think, the mid-70s, maybe. But I mean, look, how to draw crypto. Are you kidding me? And then there were these model sheets that he prepared. Once again, Look at those drawings of crypto. Are you kidding me? And then there's Lana Lang, Lois Lane's sister. Okay, and who can forget, of course, Superboy. And look at all the different expressions that Curt Swan drew of Superboy and Clark Kent. Of course, he also did incredible model sheets of Superman. You know, being able to draw a character from multiple perspectives is very, very difficult, and not every artist can do it. But man, Curt Swan was a master at it. Here he is drawing Clark Kent. Looks like a Superman model sheet. Again, nobody's drawn Superman better. I'm sorry. I mean, I know art is subjective, but just these faces alone, which DC Comics printed in 1966. You know, back then, they didn't give credit. We didn't know even Curt Swan's name. We just knew he was the good Superman artist. But around 1966, they called him Curtis Swan. This might have been, for many of us, the first time we ever heard his name, which really is disgusting as an industry practice, that they didn't credit the artist. They made it seem like the company was the creator, which gets into a whole nother thing. But look at how one of these smiling faces became this licensed product for imitation. I guess this was their version of Velveeta. Here's another version. Now, interesting, though Curt Swan was Superman's main artist for 29 years, he didn't come of age when there was a lot of licensed packaging and products about Superman. So the ones I'm gonna show you here are literally, I mean, maybe there's two handfuls of Superman products that you could find with Curt Swan's artwork. Now, a lot of these I just found years later on the internet. But I'm telling you, I've gone to conventions, comic conventions, my whole life. I always am on the lookout for anything with Curt Swan Superman, but there's very little. Now, you see that bed sheet over there with my books on it? That was a sheet on a dealer's table maybe 15 years ago. I saw, and it had Curt Swan Superman. I had never seen a Curt Swan Superman sheet. This I found on the internet. But I went to the dealer and I said, would you sell your sheet? And I expected him to say, yeah, $300, which I probably would have paid. He said, yeah, $60. I'm like, I'll take it. But I'm telling you, folks, it's really a shame that an artist who did Superman as great as Curt Swan, that there's very little product. So when I am surfing the net and I see a product like this that actually uses Curt Swan's art, especially when they use his iconic double page spread pinup. Now, folks, remember I told you DC didn't give us anything? The most they gave us in 1966, this was a double page spread pinup in a comic book. So if you wanted to take it out of the staples and hang it up on your wall, you had to either buy a second issue, which was probably DC Comics, you know, marketing strategy. We'll make them buy a second. But the bottom line is, they didn't put out posters. But I gotta tell you, every kid that loves Superman had this hanging up on their wall. But again, it's a double page spread in a comic book, so it's like this big. But you can see that this image was used in advertising and promotion that, again, the images I showed you up front are recurring in this presentation. But again, during his time in the 60s, when there was a piece of real advertising art, the client went to DC Comics and they would get Curt Swan to draw it if the licensor was willing to pay the fee. Now, this image looks like a knockoff of Curt Swan's. That doesn't actually look like Curt Swan, but you know what else Curt Swan illustrated all through the 60s? Were a series of these public service ads that DC would place that would promote the more liberal societal agenda pretty much from the Kennedy administration on down, of brotherhood and the United Nations. And again, Curt Swan's realistic artwork made even these public service announcements come alive. But in 1964, this ad on the back of every DC Comics, this is what got us really excited. Remember I told you DC didn't give us any models or statuettes or figurines? But Aurora, this model company in West Hempstead, gave us this Superman model. Now, we were entranced by Curt Swan's drawing of it. This is what a finished model actually looked like. Doesn't exactly look like Curt Swan's Superman, but you know, given that there was nothing else, we'll take it. Now, look at the drawing down below of the kid holding the Superman box. Now, that's not Curt Swan's art, and in fact, it looks like the George Reeves television Superman. We all know him, of course, from the 1950s. But once again, even as a kid, I was like, George Reeves doesn't look like Curt Swan's Superman. I mean, are you kidding me? That's what we wanted to see on the screen. So when Curt Swan would draw Superman in these regal stances, a lot of times, Curt Swan was able to draw a Superman more at rest, more at peace, in positions and expressions that most superhero artists did not draw often or could not pull off. But you can see reading this dialogue and seeing the very natural human stance that Curt Swan put Superman in, you don't have to know what this story is about to feel the weight on Superman's shoulders by the expression on his face, by the lighting, and you gotta love that old school Bende dot coloring if you know what I'm talking about. But some of these images come from a 1962 Superman story. 2 years after the death of Superman that I showed you before, DC Comics said, okay, we'll give you another take. This one's not an imaginary story. This is really the last days of Superman. Now, this four-panel sequence is maybe one of my most favorite four panels of Curt Swan ever. And yet, what is he doing? If you read the dialogue, he just found out he's got some incurable disease and he's gonna die. I mean, it's Superman looking out a window. And yet, as you read the dialogue, remember, it's the job of an illustrator. When a writer writes a story ahead of time, the illustrator has to read the text and bring it to life. So Curt Swan, the illustrator, is reading this text and giving us images that make the dialogue and the captions come alive. I love this final, I love all four panels, but that final panel, nothing can save me, but I've got 30 days left. This is my last, I mean, that is just a beautiful image. And his expressions that he gave Superman. Again, as you read the dialogue and you look at the drawing, comics are a symbiotic word-picture collaboration. You can look at the drawing and then read the text. You can read the text, look at the drawing, doesn't matter. But as you read the text and look at the image, it creates a third reality. 1 + 1 = 3. This story featured another great scene of Superman dying in the glass case because he was infected. Oh, gee, right? Torn from today's headlines. The very first page of the story, known as the splash page, featured this incredible image. Now, I'm a nice Jewish boy, but I know my Christian history, and you can't tell me that's not a Superman version of Christ coming down from the cross. In fact, in 1973, Pastor John Galloway wrote this book called The Gospel According to Superman. Now, that's not a Curt Swan image. And by the way, that was a takeoff on the 1965 book, The Gospel According to Peanuts, in which the author Robert Short found a lot of Christological significance in the work of Charles Schulz. So, 8 years later, Galloway writes a similar book. But the Gospel According to Superman is really the Gospel according to his editor for 30 years, Mort Weisinger, whose name I mentioned before. Now, Mort Weisinger is the editor of Superman. He goes back to 1933 when he was a teenager editing the science fiction fanzine, The Time Traveler, that featured Jerry Siegel's short story with illustrations by Schuster called The Reign of the Superman, where Superman was a villain and he kind of looks like the future Lex Luthor. But that's how far back Weisinger goes with his attachment to Superman. In 1940, he starts to edit Superman. This is a 1942 issue that contains the only story he actually wrote. But for the next 30 years, he was Superman's editor, which means he assigned the stories. He assigned the art. During the 1950s, he was story editor of the Superman TV series. Here he's shown with the executive producer from DC named Whitney Ellsworth. They're probably out in California. But it was when Weisinger found his artistic muse in Curt Swan in the mid-50s and assigned him to Superman that we got this rebirth of Superman, this renaissance, as it were, that began in June of 1958, the month I was born, believe it or not. And it starts with Mort Weisinger establishing so many of the lore of Superman, like the Fortress of Solitude with the giant key, with Curt Swan illustrating, that we get in the late 50s and into the 60s, the Superman family. And it all comes from, really, the mind and the worldview of Mort Weisinger. Now, Mort Weisinger was a very divisive figure. The people that worked for him, by and large, did not like working for him. And yet, the stories he told with his artists and writers became the Superman lore for 30 years. Now, his son, Hank Weisinger, is a professional psychiatrist. He's written many books about self-help and things like that. And I got to interview Hank about 10 years ago about his father because I was interested in the fact that how could a guy that was disliked by the people that he worked with, and yet the stories he created, mostly with Curt Swan, are beloved. There's a disconnect there. So by researching whatever Mort Weisinger had written about Superman and combining it with Hank Weisinger's interview, I came up with this little part of the presentation. So these are the words of Mort Weisinger. From 1940 to 1970, I was editor of the Superman comic books. It was my job to plot his adventures, invent startling super feats, create new villains, manipulate his romantic life, and involve him in missions with celebrities. Hank Weisinger said, missions with celebrities like Alan Funt. Hank Weisinger said, one day my father comes home and says, Hank, have you ever heard of Antonino Rocca? I went nuts. Antonino Rocca would fight with his bare feet, slap you in the face. He was like a human monkey, like a superhero in the wrestling world. Well, my father said, his publicist, she's a friend of mine, so I'll help you. I'll have a cover with Rocca throwing Superman out of the ring. Because of that, my father got her to get me 4 tickets to the biggest wrestling event ever at Madison Square Garden. My friends got to go, and we all met the wrestlers backstage. Hank Weisinger said the Superman mythology, it was more than just co-created. It was really developed by my father. But he had to fight DC Comics to get his credit. He used to say, Donenfeld was not my boss, Leibowitz was not my boss. I have 60 million bosses, the readers. And I enjoyed surprising the readers. I would bring out a new element every 6 months to keep the enraptured kids who were our audience involved. Superman proved that thrills can be combined with education. The same technique that Horatio Alger once used to instill into youngsters an appealing concept of the American way of life. Hank Weisinger said, "My father loved and admired John F. Kennedy. So naturally, he put him in a story which ran at the time of the assassination. A few weeks later, he called me down and said, 'Hank, look at this letter I just received.' Hank said it read, 'Dear editor, thank you for remembering my uncle. It was signed Robert Kennedy Jr.' I called the White House to make sure it was authentic, and it was, to see if I could publish it. I was told, of course, JFK was a great Superman fan, which is why Superman was JFK's spokesman for physical fitness. Superman waged incessant war against injustice, intolerance, bigotry, and other down-to-earth villains of modern society. He's immortal. He's invulnerable. And even bad scripts can't hurt him. His standard quote was, 'Be original.' He'd say, 'We're all ripping off each other, but I do it the most original way.' His favorite type of story, the type where somehow Superman lost his powers and had to survive on his natural wits. I do that repeatedly. People like Superman when he's thinking, rather than when he's just using his superpowers. One of the ways I was able to plot Superman was to pretend that I was Superman. I often fantasized what I would do as the Man of Steel. What would my problems be? And how would I react if I were this magnificent character? The number one thing I remember fantasizing that I'd do if I were Superman was this. I would warn the whole world, stay away from all places where there was any ammunition. Then I would turn on my heat vision from space, and all the ammunition in the world would be blown up. Then there couldn't be any more wars. People used to ask me why Superman didn't simply do that, stop all wars, and win our fights. I tell them that Superman thinks we should fight and win our own battles. Hank Weisinger said Superman never bought love. You can't make people love you. That's what he was really saying with Superman, that he didn't use his powers to force people to love him. When people asked me what I did for a living, Mort said, I would suppress the fact that I was editing Superman. Subconsciously, if I said I was involved with Superman, I was a big man, but shining in Superman's reflected glory. I was his satellite, and I resented it. Secretly, I was jealous of Superman, just as Clark Kent is. As Clark Kent, he was in love with Lois Lane, but he knew that she regarded him as a spineless weakling and really loved Superman. Clark was aware that if he told her the truth, she would throw herself into his arms. But he wanted her to love him for himself, not because he was Superman. So Clark was insanely jealous of Superman. It was like a schizoid personality. For 30 years of my life, I chased around the universe with that flashing figure in red and blue, the mighty Superman, linked to him like a Siamese twin. Am I sorry I split from Superman after having virtually been his soulmate for 30 years? I have mixed emotions. Hank Weisinger said we'd go on a vacation, and as much as he would feel Superman was demeaning to him, within 5 minutes at any resort we were at, everybody knew he was the editor of Superman. He was like, I'll use Superman when it's good for my ego. And then, of course, when they would just be asking you about Superman, it would drive him nuts. Superman gave me a hang-up. The incessant deadline pressure sent me to a shrink, gave me an ulcer, hypertension, and insomnia. I wasn't dealing with something of my own. I wanted to get into a world where I was my own boss, where I was truly responsible for my own work. You either are or you aren't a complete artist. One man should do all and never have to rely on others or accept something that doesn't represent him at his best. There should be a movement for the integrity of the artist and his best expression. Hank Weisinger said, my father spent his life looking to get outside of comics. He was planning to exit from DC, but they kept hooking him in with stock options. He wasn't edged out. He left because he'd had enough of this. His psychology became, as he freed himself from Superman, you can't do without me, but I can exist without you. That's what this image represents. He said, I finally realized I can make a lot more money and be happier without Superman. Ironically, he finally was edged out in 1970. He died in 1978, I think at the age of 65. And you can see that during the 1970s, these were the kind of articles that appeared interviewing Mort Weisinger about how much he hated Superman. So he was replaced by the great DC editor, Julius Schwartz. And the best move he made regarding Curt Swan was to team him up with the great DC inker named Murphy Anderson. Murphy Anderson had been at DC since the 50s, drawing every one of their superheroic characters. As an inker, he inked all the Justice League of America covers. He both penciled and inked all the Justice Society characters, which took place on Earth 2. In 1969, he even penciled and inked the first Sesame Street ad. So Schwartz first tried him out inking some covers that Curt Swan penciled. And you can see this one as it's brought to life in color. This is circa 1969, 1970. And obviously, this new version of Superman, penciled by Swan, but given a little bit more of a ruggedness by Murphy Anderson, gave Curt Swan a kind of artistic renaissance in the 1970s. Starting with the January 1971 issue, he was teamed up with Curt Swan, and over the next couple of years, they would produce a body of Superman artwork that Superman aficionados still debate to this day. Who was Curt Swan's greatest inker? Was it Murphy Anderson? Or was it the earlier inker who, I'm sorry I didn't credit, the great George Klein? But you can see that having Murphy Anderson inker seemed to rejuvenate Swan. So all of the superstations of the cross, now under this new artistic renaissance, had a kind of a new look to them. It was the same flying figure of Swan with the fist up and the knee bent, but again, given a kind of a new gravitas. In that first issue, the big deal was that they did away with kryptonite. Now, Curt Swan, remember, he was a realistic artist. Good luck trying to draw Superman chewing a piece of kryptonite and pull it off. But that's what Curt Swan did. Again, the same great flying figures, but with a new kind of rich gravitas that Swan never had before. When you look at the last page of that first issue in 1971, you can really study the beautiful anatomy of Curt Swan. Again, there's a realism and there's a weight to these figures that every artist struggles to achieve, but not every artist achieves. And again, beginning in 1971, Swan was rejuvenated. And you can see in the splash pages I'm going to show you, all of the superstations of the cross are now given a literal new dimension of dynamism. It's the same flying figures, but now we're at a slightly different angle that we had never seen before. We never saw Swan Pencil Superman coming at us quite like that before. The falling figures. I mean, just study the figures in the top panel and how beautifully they're drawn, along with the beautiful figures in the bottom three panels. And then again, Curt Swan's ability to draw Superman in repose, Superman at rest, was something that is still to this day unparalleled. I like his layouts. They become more dynamic during this time period. And look at this kind of gothic, obviously it features Batman, but Swan and Anderson teamed up for some of his greatest covers in the 1970s. Again, I could have filled up an entire lecture just on the great covers of Curt Swan. Look at the beautiful coloring of all those moon rocks. And literally, out of this world, these were epic tabloid-sized covers that they did. Anyway, Swan continues to draw Superman under Julius Schwartz's editorship up until 1986, his 29th year, where DC Comics, the Brain Trust, and I'm using air quotes around Brain Trust, they decided, enough of Curt Swan, let's try a whole different look for Superman. So Swan drew the final issue of Superman in Action Comics, and it was a great story written by Alan Moore, who wrote Watchmen and so many of the great comics we have today, maybe the greatest living comic writer, but he was a Superman Swan fan, and he pleaded with Julius Schwartz, let me write the last Curt Swan story. And it features, these are inks by the great DC artist George Perez, who passed away a couple months ago, but once again, a full page image of Superman crying. There's no dialogue, there's a little bit of a caption. And again, look at that beautiful crypto. But you can feel Superman's emotion. You don't even have to know what the story's about to feel that emotion. And that's the power of great artwork, that it can make you feel an emotion from, as Robert Crumb would say, that are just lines on paper, folks. And that was the last cover of Action Comics, as only Curt Swan and Murphy Anderson could draw it. Here they are, taken late in life, probably this is in the early 90s, Schwartz on the left, Murphy Anderson in the center, Swan on the right. This is probably late 80s, early 90s maybe. But in 1992, the Museum of Modern Art featured its first Andy Warhol posthumous retrospective. And I remember getting the catalog, and inside was a double-page spread of these seven collages that were all about 11 by 14 inches. And I had never seen them before. Now, remember I showed you Andy Warhol's image from 1961. 20 years later, 1981, he does the silkscreen, which is, of course, based on, remember that image I showed you about 15 minutes ago? That's what Warhol used for that silk screen. But I had never seen these collages before. So I'm looking at them, and I go, they're dated 1960, which means These were done before Warhol even did his first pop art painting. But I remember reading Superman as a kid, and I said, that's not from 1960. That's from 1967. So how could a collage using a cut-up Superman panel be dated 1960 using artwork from 1967? They're forgeries, folks. So I had a friend who was a comic book buddy. His sister worked for the San Francisco Chronicle, and they wrote an article because most of the collages used Curt Swan's images. But once again, dated 1961, the comic was from 1964. Now, whether Warhol did these forgeries himself, or if you know the way he worked, maybe one of his assistants did, but whoever did was cutting up these panels going, nobody's gonna wanna know, because nobody respects comics. Historians in the art fields like photography and sculpture, they don't know comic book history, and the forger counted on that ignorance. And that is a sad statement about something I've spent my career trying to elevate comic book art as a respected art form. So what did I do in response? I did this illustration in 1992 called Super Fraud. Look, comic Richard Scheinhaus, my friend, Scheinhaus and Schumer team up. I brought this to every New York media outlet. Nobody wanted to touch the story. Why? Because maybe the Warhol up on their wall that they spent thousands of dollars for, maybe that's a forgery too. Andy Warhol, if you know his history, had his mother sign his work. Anyway, 4 years later, Curt Swan passed away. I'm lucky enough to say I was able to meet him 4 years earlier in 92. That's where I got that signature. After he passed away, I did a slideshow eulogy pre-computer at the Connecticut chapter of the National Cartoonist Society at the Cobbs Mill Inn. And if I remember correctly, some of the members of Curt Swan's family were there. And I haven't seen you guys, and I'm honored by your presence in the back there. But my greatest memory of the slideshow eulogy, because as you can see, it was the same Curt Swan love fest as this one is right now. But his family came up to me in tears, thanking me. And I'm a little verklempt even recalling that. So thank you again for being here. But a video of it is still on my YouTube channel. It's not the greatest video, but it was the very first version of what I'm showing you really tonight. So 2 years later, this was the museum, the Words and Pictures Museum in Northampton, Massachusetts. It's now defunct, run by one of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle guys with all the money that they made. And in 1998, they had a 60th anniversary of Superman exhibition. And in their beautiful museum in Northampton, they had these giant glass panels, 54 inches by 27 inches, and there were six of them. And they said, Arlen, can you do something about the history of Superman? So I wrote and designed these 54 inch by 27 inch murals of the art history of Superman. So there's the, you know, early images. There's Wayne Boring, the artist that preceded Curt Swan. And there's my Curt Swan panel, which again, I've been recycling these images literally for decades. I took this great cover by Curt Swan and Murphy Anderson, circa 1972, and I turned it into this image, Requiem for Weisinger Comics, called I Sustain the Wings, and it was done for a comic book trade magazine called Alter Ego. Came out in 2012, 10 years ago. And it's basically what I read to you and showed you a little while ago, but it's in magazine form. So these are double page spreads, but you can see these are all the images I've been showing you and the words of Mort Weisinger and his muse, Curt Swan's images, in a kind of what I call a verbal visual essay. But you can see these are all the images and all the words that I just showed you and read you, but in a form that you can read it kind of like a comic book. But it's using Curt Swan's images and Weisinger's words. So you can see how in two-dimensional print form, I collage the images so that they would work as 8.5 by 11 pages. This is one of my favorite. You know, people think I photoshopped that Siamese twin image. Nope, that was the actual image that Curt Swan drew. And the final page is my revision of that favorite Curt Swan cover. By the way, inked by George Klein, pre-Murphy Anderson. He was the inker I grew up with as identifying with Curt Swan's art. And it was because I was able to get this black and white image that was in the only bio of Curt Swan, came out in 2002 by Eddie Zeno, published by Vanguard. But I got to do the 16-page color section. The rest of the book is black and white. And once again, you'll recognize the images that I've been showing you. This spread I call emotions. And again, the subtlety of the emotions, drawing people crying, very, very difficult. Curt Swan pulled it off. Even the male embrace, which is very hard for male artists to draw without being accused of you know what, Swan was able to pull off the male embrace. I love, remember, these subtle images of Superman in repose, at rest. There's a beauty to these images. You know, not all superhero images have to be these bombastic, dynamic images. The Superboy spread, trying to get that Norman Rockwell feeling that I showed you in his work. Ah, the Legion of Superheroes spread with the death of Ferrolad. DC Comics, I'll never forgive you. Boy, tough crowd. You know what I mean by tough crowd? That's a tough crowd. Okay. You know, I could have done a whole lecture just on his Jimmy Olsen work. I didn't even show his Jimmy Olsen work. He did just as many covers of Jimmy Olsen stories as he did of Superboy. Again, that's a whole nother presentation. He also drew Superman and Batman in World's Finest, the team-up title. And the image on the right, that character is called the Composite Superman. You know, DC Comics taught an entire generation words like composite. You think any other third grader knew what the word composite meant? No. But DC Comics taught us that. It was the greatest wish fulfillment of all of us young fans. What if Superman and Batman could somehow be squished together? But the last page of the color section is my favorite with that great statue. Of all the recurrent imagery in Swan's Superman career, it is finally the statues, monuments, and memorials that are the most revealing of Swan's nature. For they depict an artist whose style mirrored his name, that of a swan itself, graceful and dignified, yet strong and resolute, permeated with an air of solemnity. They are literally heroic models, some of the most iconic in the history of comics. They form the signature motif of Curt Swan's artistic legacy. Now, this was the last page of the color section, but this was the first page, modeled after those old annuals of DC that had the insets. But you can see that I've been recycling this image over and over again, and it's the image that will close this presentation on Curt Swan, the Baby Boom Generation Superman artist. But ladies and gentlemen, before I go, I want to show you a little PS. Here we are at the Westport Library. This photo looks like it could have been taken today, right? If you go down by the Riverwalk, there are memorial plaques that people, I guess, could purchase and have illustrated on them. And sure enough, there is Curt Swan's plaque. In memory of Curt Swan, Westport artist, loving father, gentle human, a Superman, the Swan family. Well, when I first saw it, when I moved here, I was like, that's not Curt Swan's Superman. That's this artist, Brett Breeding, I think his name is, from the early 90s. I'm like, are you kidding me? I would have taken this image of Superman, one of his greatest images, and I mocked up what the plaque should have looked like. So, ladies and gentlemen, I can think of no better way to end this presentation by making a call to who's ever responsible to change that plaque.